borrow from the quantum Hall state and Chern insulators have been applied to study or characterize the spin wave spectrum and magnetic excitation in a magnetic system. And of course, we have the example of solitons. So essentially, nonlinear excitations, magnetic textures that behave as particles and in many cases are described or characterized by a topological invariant. OK, so please interrupt me any time you have a question. OK, so in this recent work, we actually proposed to use one example of these solitons, particular skinnion textures in a chiral magnet, to as carriers of spin signals that can be transmitted over long distances, essentially thanks to the topological protection of the skinnion charge of this topological invariant. So the idea is more or less represented here in this picture. So imagine we have a setup like this. So we place a magnetic insulator between two metals. And this magnetic insulator, this thin film, hosts metastable skinnion textures stabilized by some relativistic interaction that could be either intrinsic or extrinsic induced by a substrate, for instance. And the main assumption is that there must be a strong exchange interaction between the 18N spins in the metal and the localized spin degrees of freedom in the magnet in such a way that when we pass a current through one of the contacts, this current exerts a force on the magnetization dynamics that essentially works in favor of the nucleation of skirmions at this boundary. So essentially, by passing a current, we are pumping a skirmion charge into the system that now diffuses due to thermal agitation over the bulk of the system and eventually reaches the second terminal. And now the annihilation of these skirmion textures in this terminal by the reciprocal effect is going to pump internal spins in the opposite direction. And that sustains a drag signal, a negative drag signal, that decays only algebraically with the distance between metals, similarly to a spin superfluid, and in clear contrast to spin waves or magnetic excitation. So this is reflecting the topological protection of this skirmion charge that we are pumping into the system. OK, so essentially, what I'm going to discuss today is I'm going to extend these ideas to the case when these skirmions essentially nucleate a form of regular lattice, a skirmion crystal, in such a way that this drag effect and related magnetoresistance signatures that I'm going to discuss can be employed to characterize the phase diagram of chiral magnets. So here, for instance, I'm showing the phase diagram for these insulating helium magnets, these copper oxoselenides, that in particular, when they are reduced to a thin film, they show a very broad region in their phase diagram hosting a stabilized skirmion lattice. So essentially what we propose is to use this kind of transport signatures in this kind of two-terminal devices as an alternative to neutron scattering and electron microscopy techniques that are usually employed to characterize these systems. OK, so this is essentially one of the motivations of the work. So this brings me to the outline of my talk. So in the first part, I'm going to discuss the dynamics of the formations of these skirmion crystals. And I'm going to construct the boundary conditions for these dynamics provided by the non-equilibrium torques generated by currents at metals at the interface with these magnets. And then I will apply this theory to solve the magnetoelectric dynamics in this two-terminal geometry that I was showing you before. I'm going to discuss only the steady-state response, and I'm going to get expressions for the drag, and I will discuss also some related magnetoresistance signatures. And at the very end, I will discuss very briefly how this can be applied to characterize this phase diagram of these chiral magnets. OK. So essentially, what I'm going to do is to develop an elasticity theory that relies on two main ideas or two main assumptions. Essentially. So what I'm going to do is to describe the skirmion lattice regarded as a continuous media. That means that I'm going to introduce a collective field variable that essentially represents the displacement of the skirmions, the center of mass of the skirmions with respect to their equilibrium positions in the skirmion lattice. Okay? And I'm going to neglect like the actual profile of the magnetization texture. Okay? So this is one idea. And the other is that essentially, the linear momentum of the whole crystal only changes through forces applied at the boundaries of the system. And this implies, this is just the consequence of conservation of linear momentum. And that implies that, in particular, the force acting on a given element of this Skirmion lattice can be written as the divergence of a second rank tensor. And this second rank tensor is nothing but a stress tensor. So I'm going to construct this stress tensor just from general symmetry arguments. And this is going to what is going to define, essentially, the dynamics in the bulk of the system. Okay, so this is more or less the problem. So here's some details. No? So the starting point, of course, is the Landau-Dilis-Fried dynamics that I'm expressing here in this Hamiltonian, let's say, formulation. So this equation describes the dynamics of the magnetization density at temperatures well below the ordinary temperatures. Essentially, we are neglecting fluctuations, but somehow, as is evident from this structure of this Poisson bracket, can be understood as the classical descendant of the quantum spin dynamics. Anyway, so what I'm going to do, as I say, is to introduce certain collective field variables in order to parameterize this field. And I'm going to constrain the dynamics to the phase space of textures, of rigid textures. Essentially, all the dynamics of the texture, in my approximation, are going to be encrypted in the evolution of these field variables, okay? Which correspond to the softer molds of the crystal. So essentially, are the Goldstone molds of my crystal, my phonon molds, if you wish. Okay, so in this constrained phase space of rigid textures, we get an algebra of Poisson bracket like look like this. So this is like the Poisson bracket that you will get for the guiding center of a particle subjected to a magnetic field proportional to the Skirmion charge, which is the weighted number of this texture. So essentially, this parameterizes how many times the magnetic texture sweeps the block sphere within the area of the unit cell of your lattice. That enters here in order to regularize this theory, because essentially we are promoting the position to this of these Skirmions in the lattice to a continuous field, right? So this is generating this algebra is generating now the dynamics in this constrained phase space here, and this is how the equation of motion looks like. So essentially, the Magnus force equals the conservative force, or the force conjugate to the displacement of the crystal. These are the elastic force of our crystal. Okay. Okay, so another way to read this equation of motion is that the elastic force, the conjugate force to the displacement in the crystal, equals the rate of change of the canonical momentum, because the canonical variable conjugate to the displacement of these Skirmions. Actually, if we take this object and we integrate this over the entire area of the film, what we get is something that's actually, we can recognize this as the generator of translations of the Skirmion texture in this, let's say, reduced or constrained phase space of rigid textures. So, and actually from these definitions, actually, we recover the usual conservation of linear momentum, that the translational invariance of the Hamiltonian implies that this quantity is conserved. And if we just plug the equation of motion in this expression, we actually get this. We get that the density force acting on a given element of the lattice should be written as a divergence of this tensor. This is the stress tensor. So next I'm going to construct this stress tensor from general symmetry arguments. Okay? So essentially I'm going to consider which is the work carried out by these internal forces of the crystal. This is something I can write like this. And if I assume that the system is also rotationally invariant with respect to rotations along the out-of-plane axis, then this allows me to write the work in terms of this object, which is nothing like the strain tensor. So something that accounts for the deformations of this crystal, right? So if I compute the change in the free energy of the magnet due to a deformation of this Skirmion crystal, I get an expression that is something like this. Of course, neglecting dissipation for the moment. And then I get this, let's say, standard definition of what a stress tensor is, which is nothing but the isothermal change of the free energy with respect to this displacement or distortion of this Skirmion lattice. Okay, So this is telling me essentially that I can, in principle, expand this free energy density in terms of this strain tensor. And it's actually telling me something else, because both the strain and the stress tensor should be zero at equilibrium, meaning that in this expansion, the first contribution is actually quadratic in the strain tensor. So then I can do, like in any Landau theory, I'm expanding this free energy in terms of this strain tensor. And the only additional constraint that I have to impose is that this quadratic form should be invariant with respect to the symmetry of the ground state or the equilibrium state above which I'm perturbing. So in this case, usually this Skinner lattice form a triangular lattice with an evident hexagonal symmetry. So this leads to these are the two only quadratic forms that I can construct, which are compatible with hexagonal symmetry. Okay, so I could. So this is the form of the free energy just from these general symmetry arguments. I could, of course, obtain the same starting from the free energy of the magnet written in terms of the spin density field and performing an expansion in terms of these collective variables that I'm introducing, right? And then I will obtain the same result where now these elastic constants or Lamé coefficients can be written in terms of are essentially the square of the Janowski-Moriya interaction, this super exchange interaction given by relativistic interactions in the system, divided by the stiffness, the regular exchange interaction, right? This is like the estimate for this elastic constant that has units that have units of energy divided by area in this case. Okay. Okay. So questions so far? Yeah, I need some water. Sorry. The microphone is not working, right? I think it's not working, but you can hear me. Okay, it's okay. It stopped working at some point, but it's okay. I see, okay. So I think it's, well, I don't know. Is it working or? It's working, okay, so then, never mind. Ah, the battery is low. Okay. I don't know. Yeah. I think it's still not working, but it's okay. Ah, you're recording. Okay, so then never mind. Sorry. Yeah. Okay, so this is the free energy that generates the dynamics of the Skirmion lattice, right? So far I have neglected dissipation. But I can introduce dissipations in a phenomenological manner, similarly to the way we introduce dissipation in terms of Gilbert damping. So I can just write a Rayleigh function, which is just a quadratic form in the velocity of the Skirmions, in terms of a general tensor that actually can be related with the Gilbert damping. Now I multiply by a third time structure factor that takes into account the actual profile of the magnetization texture. But this is something I'm going to neglect, or actually I'm going to introduce here in the definition of my dimensionless Gilbert damping. Okay. So with the account of these dissipative forces, now the equation of motion of the displacements in the bulk of this Skirmion lattice looks like this. Essentially, we have like this dissipation dissipative force, the Magnus force that equals to the elastic response of the Skirmion crystal, whose more general form looks like this. Okay, so this is my equation of motion, and now I have to define the boundary conditions for this equation of motion, essentially. Yes. Yeah, I will say so. Of course. Yeah, you are saying that there will be additional contribution, not exactly with this form, coming from the coupling to extra degrees of freedom. Sure. Essentially, yeah. So in this, essentially, because we are constraining the dynamics to this rigid texture, so we are completely neglecting interaction with other degrees of freedom of the magnetism, which are going to introduce, of course, dissipation generally. Yes. Okay, so now, oops, sorry. Now here. So now I have to supplement my lambda DC dynamics at the boundaries with these metals with the non-equilibrium torques generated by these electrical currents, assume third time exchange interaction, as I said before. So essentially now the goal is to express these torques in terms of these collective variables, something that I can do just by energy consideration following essentially the same kind of arguments that I was showing you before for the bulk dynamics, right? And now the way to construct the boundary conditions is just observing, as I said before, that the total change of the linear momentum of the crystal is only due to forces applied to through the boundaries. So essentially that relates the components of this force that are coming from these non-equilibrium torques in these collective variables to the components of the strain tensor evaluated at the boundaries. So essentially, this is my boundary condition. Okay. So I'm going to consider this spin transfer torque, which is like the lowest torque that you can construct in a gradient expansion of the magnetization texture. Here, J is the current density in the metal. And this parameter P measures the strength of the proximity effect between the metal and the magnetic insulator. Okay, so now what happens is that the metal essentially acts as a reservoir of energy and linear momentum of the crystal. In particular, you can compute which is the work performed by this torque, and you have a result that depends explicitly in the Skirmion charge of the texture, right? So this means we can relate this work with the work performed by a tension in these collective variables, and then what you get is this expression for this tension, in which now I have introduced this length scale that represents essentially the extension of the proximity effect within the metal. Okay. So this is like the spin transfer torque expressed in these collective field variables, again assuming a rigid injection of this Skirmion texture. Okay. Sure. So P is related to the spin polarization of the conductance. Okay. So essentially, I will say something like the spin polarized conductance over the total conductance of in your metal, in your ferromagnetic metal. Okay. Sure. It's just a phenomenal parameter here. So, yes. So both P and this length scale are in principle phenomenal parameters that you could in principle obtain from, I don't know, some kind of first principle calculation in the system. Okay, so now we have the reciprocal effect to this torque that I was showing you before. And that generates a pumping force in the metal and generates, in particular, a voltage signal. Sure. Ah, 5 minutes, OK. Yeah. That generates a voltage that can be written essentially as the rate of annihilation of this Skirmion charge that I was saying before. So this comes from spin-dependent forces that arises due to the accumulation of very phases by the itinerant spins following adiabatically the magnetization dynamics. So at the same time, simultaneously, we are generating also a spin current in the system, in principle, regardless of the value of the strength of this proximity effect. And this represents certain depletion of a spin angular momentum from the magnet to the metal that is going to be subsequently dissipated in the metal. So in now, again, in the language of these collective variables, we are essentially introducing third-time dissipative forces, an interfacial dissipative force that breaks, actually, the macroscopic time reversal symmetry of the lambda dynamics, lambda Lifshitz dynamics expressed in this variable. Okay, so we have all the elements of the theory now defined, so I'm going to now solve the magneto-electrodynamics in this two-terminal geometry that I was telling you before. So essentially, I'm going to consider the steady-state response, which means that all the Skirmions that are now represented by these dots, these are like the center of mass of this Skirmion, they move collectively with a third-time velocity v, and in the frame comobile with this with the Skirmion lattice, now the displacements are stationary, and that means that the stress, the internal stress of the Skirmion, does not depend on time in the steady state. Okay, So of course, the velocities in the equation of motion, as I showed before, are computed with respect to the static background. So of course, there are corrections here, convective correction, that I'm going to neglect in a linear response calculation. So at the end of the day, the bulk dynamics supplemented by these boundary conditions give you a set of closed equations for the velocity, which essentially is related to the rates of annihilation, of nucleation, and annihilation of ischemions at the two boundaries. And that enters especially in the expressions for the pumping force. So solving this equation, I get an expression for the drag coefficient that looks like this. This is like the general expression in which we are accounting both Gilbert damping in the bulk of the system and also damping or the interfacial damping introduced by the resistivity of the metals. Okay, and this gives rise to this drag effect that I was telling you before, and there is a related magnetoresistant effect that happens when we consider, instead of an open geometry, a closed geometry. So there is essentially a correction to the resistivity of the external circuit that depends on the configuration of the external circuit. For instance, if we close the circuit in series, the forces now, I'm assuming that the two metals are identical, the forces induced by the current now equilibrate in such a way that the ischemion crystal now is compressed, but the texture remains static. Therefore, there are no pumping and no correction to the resistivity of the circuit. Whereas if I close the circuit in parallel, I'm more or less in the same situation as in this open geometry. So the two forces, the two reactive forces here, are in the same direction. So essentially, the ischemion lattice translate, and this gives rise to a correction to the resistivity that is essentially twice the drag resistivity in the open geometry. Okay, and this is somehow implying that this correction to resistivity is accounting for the extra energy supplemented by the external battery that is now dissipated in the bulk of the magnet due to this magnetization dynamics. So we put some numbers here and we get signals, drag signals, that are actually comparable to experiments of magnetron drag in Jig. So here I'm considering cobalt contacts and numbers for these copper oxoselenides. So just let me just conclude by emphasizing again that this kind of drag effects and related magnetoresistance signals in a closed geometry can be used to characterize the phase diagram of a chiral magnet. So here I'm showing the phenomenological phase diagram that you obtain from neutron scattering experiments for thin films of this copper oxoselenide. So we see here that in the ferromagnetic order, in the collineal order, the signal is essentially mediated by a gas of solitons, and we expect like this signal decreases exponentially with the applied magnetic field. Then we enter in the ischemion crystal phase, in which essentially the ischemion density is uniform and equals essentially the inverse of the area of the unit cell. And eventually, when we enter in the helical phase, this signal is going to drop, but still can be mediated by other kind of topological defect in this helical order that also carry ischemion charge. So this could be a very interesting way to study which is the nature of this transition, and in particular, which is the role of the proliferation of topological defects like declinations and dislocations in this helical order. So this is essentially all what I wanted to say. So these are my conclusions, and I will be happy to take some of your questions if you have any. So thanks. Sure.